You listen to episode 77 of Fresh Floppies.
Yay!
Hey, this is a sad day.
Wahoo!
This is a sad day. You should respect it.
Okie dokie.
What's wrong, baby? Don't they treat you like they should? Did you take them for it?
What's up, Doris? Sidekicks and henchmen out there in the Geek Nation. You're currently listening to Fresh Floppies, a show wherein Noel and I discuss comic books that are coming out this Wednesday, brand new comic book day. It happens every week. And we're going to talk about comic books that come out, but without spoilers.
Yeah, we don't talk about spoilers.
Spoiler alert, we're not going to spoil anything.
Yeah, spoiler alert, read your own books. We're here to do the hard work.
Yeah.
The service of pre-reading as many single issue comic books as humanly possible on a 12-hour span.
Yeah.
And, you know, juggle with our lives.
Yeah.
And talk about the ones that are worth talking about that maybe you should pick up, or maybe you don't
maybe
have
no.
to.
You don't have to read them up.
See how things are going. But where are we going to start today? We're going to start with, like, probably
the biggest launch, drop, attack.
This week, which is
DC presents All In Justice League Unlimited number one by Mark Waid, Dan Mora, Tamara Bonvillain. I'm just going to get into it. I like this book a lot. I love me some Mark Waid. I love me some Dan Mora. Mark Waid has not done me wrong recently. And Dan Mora is tops. Do you concur, good doctor?
I think I hit my go, but whatever. This is wonderful. They're top of the line. They're top of their class. They're the best big two creators happening right now.
I concur with myself.
This is just the creative team of Superman, Batman, World's Finest ported over to Justice League. Mm-hmm. Justice League Ultimate.
So I think
that's the edgy one with chains.
All you need, kids love them. All you need to know is that, dear listener, is that Justice League Unlimited is basically kind of like the cartoon Justice League Unlimited, where the Justice League has said, we need more of us. So they've just opened up the membership to everyone in the world. I'm pretty sure. No, I think you're on the team.
I have a card. Yep. We all have cards. We're on the team. Yeah. They kept talking about how this is a grand experiment. I'm like, yeah, it's just a big team. Yep. But no, it's genuinely different. It's a straight up city in the sky, and everyone is invited and or put to work.
Mm-hmm.
The only issues I had with this book was just kind of like the shotgun pacing of it.
Yeah.
A couple of the problems I had with Absolute Power I saw kind of repeated in the pacing of the first third of this book.
Mm-hmm.
I completely missed. There's a it opens like in smash cut opens to an action scene, and then we get like, you know, 1 hour later.
1 hour before.
Whatever. I completely, with the coloring and the text, I completely missed that. And I'm like, okay, so I guess this is some inordinate amount of time before. And then they repeat it and they go back and then other characters somewhere else. It just, I understand what they were going for, but I kind of wanted to sit with their work for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So it had that bump for me. And it's such a deep in the weeds complaint.
I think one of the interesting rides to line the kind of the fun of having such a big team is for the writer to bounce these characters off each other that you may not get usually.
Mm-hmm.
But then also trying to balance that with big action. So I think it's a very difficult sort of thing to do, to pull off. And I'm hoping we get a little bit more character interaction. We get some here, especially with a new character who was introduced in Absolute Power.
Airwave. To your point, I want more of that and less of the
Bang Pow.
I kind of want the Bang Pow to be earned. Mm-hmm. I have a minor bugaboo gripe.
Be in your bonnet?
Be in my bonnet of with the coloring. Tamara Bonvillain is just so awesome, but these nighttime action scenes, you don't really get to see the intricacy of the line work.
Mm.
When there were nighttime scenes during Dan Moore's and Kieran Gillen's Once in Future, the coloring kind of, and I think it actually was Tamara Bonvillain.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, the coloring kind of leaned into a neon hued aesthetic. So even in the dark, you could see what was going on with the line work.
Lots of pinks, purples.
Here it's a little bit more of an air quotes realism. Mm-hmm. And I'm not entirely sold it does the art a service.
Right.
Or at least the storytelling a service, because, you know, like it's nighttime and there's an explosion. Realistically, it would be dark and the explosion is the only thing that lights the room. Mm-hmm. Pacing wise and panel wise, it makes it seem messy where I'm missing a beat unless I sit there and study it.
Okay.
So like I think I want my heroes in the daytime. I want my heroes in the lights.
Yeah. I did not have that problem at all. I think it's a gorgeous book. I like the colors. I like Dan Mora always and forever.
Look, I'm complaining about the frame on a piece of artwork. All right. This is not like a, hey, you're all trash. This is I wish it just had a touch.
Just like a boop.
5% over here.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Because I want to see what's going on, not just feel what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And for me, this was fresh AF.
It's fresh.
If you're into like superheroics, this is a book to pick up.
Another book that I would advocate people pick up is DC Black Canary Best of the Best number one, written by Tom King with art by Ryan Sook. Mm. This is a, I guess this isn't Black Label, but it kind of feels like a Black Label book.
Oh, it does.
It is basically a match between Black Canary, who I guess is a wonderful fighter, and Lady Shiva, who is the greatest fighter.
Lady Shiva.
So, there's...
Couldn't believe it.
This doesn't make any real sense, but I enjoyed it. So basically, it's a boxing match between these two warriors, and it's being broadcast to 2 billion people on Earth, and then because Dinah has fans across the cosmos with all of her various Justice League gang. they're also watching it in different planets. This is wrestling with very little setup just to tell a story of this character. Mm. So I feel like haters of Tom King's work, this will be an example of everything they dislike because he doesn't take any time, or honestly, I don't think he gives a shit about why they're in this situation or the things that led to this situation. Like, because if you think about it for 2 seconds, like why would a vigilante want to bother in a sanctioned wrestling slash, or it's more like a mixed martial arts fight on television against an assassin.
Yeah, and also, why would a mysterious assassin who want to be fighting on television?
Just yada yada that. Because really what this boils down to is basically just like a fun character study of Dinah Lance.
Yeah.
And that's where it's strong.
And her mom.
And her mom, who I don't really know much about, the original Black Canary. But there's a couple of really wonderful little bits of prose and dialogue in here that I thought was really wonderful. The idea of, like, he also plays a lot, like, he plays with the canary, like, the harbinger of doom and or death and or the savior that you send in first.
Yeah.
And I think that is such a wonderful little, like, nugget of Dinah. This book has a lot of the Tom King tropes. He takes the idea of announcers and he makes that kind of the main text box dialogue of like we have narrators. This book has narrators and it's two fight announcers. They are verbose, they're loquacious, they have $10 vocabularies, which honestly boxing and wrestling announcers often do.
I don't have a lot of boxing and or does this ring true?
You are constantly talking because the action in the ring is all physical, so you're constantly talking over it. And yes, they fill space. I think there's a thesaurus next to them and they just kind of keep like flowing because there's no music. There's nothing that'll swell. It's just two people punching each other. So usually the announcers are throwing in stats. They're talking about background. They're trying to make it more of a story that's happening in the ring. And that's
for people who aren't able to watch.
Exactly. And that's exactly what this is doing. So I could totally see flipping this and being like, that's a lot of words.
Yeah.
but I didn't have trouble with it. I actually really liked it. I didn't either.
I really enjoyed this book. And I laughed out loud, I think harder than I have laughed in quite a while at the double page yes. splash that happens in the middle.
I think we can. That was Ryan Sook shared this online.
Oh, did he?
Like weeks ago. So I've seen this double page splash before.
Yeah.
It's basically
the JLU.
Just various members of the Justice League in their civvies watching the fight from
TV,
home.
Yeah.
The only thing that kind of ruined it for me was, I mean, they don't get seats. Like, they don't want to be at the ring. They don't want
to
be there.
You don't get to be there at the actual fight.
You guys aren't in a box. Yeah. But then again, they also all have secret identities, so maybe not.
It's true, yeah.
But did you clock everyone?
Yes. Yes, I think so. Except for...
That's Hawkman, right? That's Carter Hall. That's got to be.
Oh, is that who that is?
Yeah, he's wearing like...
You're right.
Yeah, that's got to be Carter Hall. And that was the only one that it took me kind of a second.
I was thinking Hal, but then Hal's behind him.
Yep, Hal and John are behind him.
Yeah.
I don't see Bruce anywhere.
Would Bruce come to a...
A barbecue?
You know what? He's in the bathroom brooding.
Or he's just like at the boxing match in the rafters under a shadow watching.
You had mentioned
that
this fight, what are they called? Announcers?
Yeah.
We're going to be doing every issue. And
I didn't say that. Oh. Every issue's a round.
Okay. I'm sorry. So the storytelling style that we're in with them kind of talking over every single panel mm-hmm. was great for an issue. I'm not sure if I can stick with it for multiple issues.
I wouldn't be surprised if it does, but the construct of this book is that it's six rounds. That's
kind of fun.
Germane to the plot that it's six rounds.
Yeah, it is.
So each issue will be around. And Dinah is wildly undervalued.
She's the underdog.
She's very much the underdog.
It's like 7-1.
Yeah.
And then it even goes up from there.
Yeah. Which is fun. And, dude, Ryan Sook.
Ryan, come on.
Ryan Sook, where you been, my guy? Well, it takes you forever to draw a book. That's where you've been here.
Yeah,
this is where you've been
for a decade.
And it's good to see you.
Drawing this. It's delicious. I love it.
This is such a good book. And like, there are some sequences in here, especially the fighting. I'd never noticed this about his work before, but is he like channeling a little bit of Frank Cho?
I could see a little bit of
Frank Cho. Like, yeah. I mean, like, not in the faces, not in his facial acting, I think, is like on par with McGuire. But
like bodies?
Bodies. Yeah, I'm getting a little Frank Cho, especially like the most recent stuff.
Mm-hmm. It's goddamn gorgeous.
This is a great book. I think it's fresh AF.
Same.
And honestly, this seems like the kind of book because if I think it's going to go where I think it is in regards to like the you know, framing devices with the announcers mm-hmm. and stuff, this will read better in issues than it does in trade.
Yeah.
100%. Mm-hmm. So I would suggest people pick this up in issues.
It doesn't feel like some of his other works where if you read it in issues, you might get lost month to month because mm-hmm. there's so much going on. This feels like, I know exactly what happened last issue.
He likes to sometimes play with like repetition or mirroring, and that'll do really well in issues. Not unlike Killing Time, which we talk about, I think, every week now.
Yeah.
that had a very verbose framing device that was revealed as to what it was in like issue 5. In issues, very palatable. In trade, probably very repetitious. Mm-hmm. And I think he understands the difference between trade and issue.
Yeah.
Like, in how to decompress or not decompress a story because people are waiting for it. That's something I think that he had to learn the hard way in regards to his Batman run. Mm-hmm. Because there were some times when he left a cliffhanger off for like 6 months.
Yup.
And it's like, okay, that's a trade thing. Let's lean more into like issue thing. But anyway,
I will say that there is a nice reveal at the end of this as well.
Yeah, this is a great book. Great book. Fresh AF.
Yeah. Amazing Spider-Man number 62 came out this week. We've been on the Amazing Spider-Man train for quite a while. However, no, last time with issue 61, you were like, I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to keep going. So take it away. Are you going to keep going?
I don't know. I like the plot of the book,
uh-huh.
but I genuinely don't like Peter's voice in this.
Really?
Yeah, no, not at all.
I was surprised by how much it doesn't bother me, considering I haven't liked this writer in the past. Oh, by the way, I'm sorry.
Joe Kelly
and Ed McGuinness. Yeah.
There's the plot mechanics are really fun. The idea in this new suit, and I am a giant sucker for Black Cat. Use her more.
Oh my god! Yes.
So
if, I'm still not over them being broken up.
If she continues, I'm in. But it's overplotted. It's just so overplotted, and sometimes that's really fun, mm-hmm. like slapdash and fun. I started to glaze over like it's gibberish.
Well, I mean, that's my problem with Doctor Strange.
It's not my problem with Doctor Strange. It's my problem with Peter doing it. But the art is so good. The idea of this is so good. I'm on a razor's edge of not liking this, but there's so much to like though. The genuine how he one-ups the baddie mm-hmm. is genuinely creative. All of this is really wildly creative, and
it's
fun.
So creative, I don't understand it, but I don't want to spoil it, so we'll talk off air. But I was like, what, that doesn't make any sense to me at all. It's not supposed to. It's supposed to be beyond the realms of
theoretically it makes sense,
physically possible,
but theoretically when you theorize at that level, it doesn't make sense.
I'm
hanging by a thread. I don't really care for Joe Kelly's version of Spider-Man. This is not unlike when we were reading Slott's Spider-Man, adjectiveless Spider-Man.
Yeah,
that first arc was kind of fun with all the crazy universe stuff or multi Spider-Verse stuff, and then it got into basically the plot was hinging on Peter making the mistakes of a 12-year-old.
Right.
And that I just wasn't...
Didn't like that?
I didn't care for that too much.
It doesn't
much.
Bother me here because he's in a completely different thing that he's not used to.
Yes. And that's kind of what's saving me. It's just like, Peter, I know you're a fuck-up, but you're not this dumb.
Right.
I'm accepting it because this is a realm he's not around.
Yeah.
I just don't know if I enjoy it. Mm-hmm. It's not like a... With the Slott stuff, it was like, oh, you're making him this dumb to purpose your plot.
Right.
With this, it's like, I don't know if I like Peter in this space, but I like the idea of slamming him in this space.
Yeah.
And the art is really, really doing 99% of the work for my enjoyment.
It's such
in this.
A good looking book.
So like I'm still down and I want to know how this ends, but I don't think I'd like Joe Kelly on Spider-Man.
Yeah. I mean, that's been my go-to for a while now.
It's not plot. It's not like they're ruining my character. I just don't know if I love the voice.
Yeah.
I don't love his voice. And you know what? It's I tried reading Joe Kelly's celebrated run of Deadpool. Didn't like it.
Yeah. I also don't care about Deadpool. So.
But it just his style. It's just not for me.
Cadence.
Yeah. It's just not for me. We'll see.
I will say this conversation. There's a very simple scene here where him and his friends were having some conversation, and I got lost in a one-page conversation that they were having, and I don't want to spoil it, but I was like, I read that conversation 2 to 3 times being like, wait, what?
Yeah.
But the rest of it I thought was really fun.
I like the plot, I like the art. I don't care as much for the writing. So if you're just, falling downhill and enjoying Spider-Man, awesome. I hope that this is just an in-between and we find out what the real run is going to be.
Oh, yes. I mean, I think that's what it is.
Sure.
The 8th Deaths of Spider-Man. But I hope it's not Joe Kelly. Sorry, Joe Kelly.
Maybe it's my own expectations, but it really does feel like filler. Hmm. And I don't want a book that feels like filler.
Yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah. Speaking of filler... We're going to talk about Venom War, number 5 of 5. The great event written by Al Ewing with art by Ivan Coella, with all your favorite characters.
Maybe I don't like Al Ewing.
You do, though. Maybe you don't like Al Ewing and Venom War.
Yeah, definitely. Venom. I definitely don't like that.
Because the Immortal Hulk was fantastic and something else. His Guardians was absolutely awesome.
Was that
Ultimates
the one
where was pretty
cool. Western...
No,
that was somebody else.
That's Lansing and Jackson.
Venom War, the end of it.
So fucking convoluted. This book is so convoluted.
Why is he gold?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
I mean, I talking about this would spoil something and everything and nothing.
So you, I gave up on this book issues ago. You have stuck with it. You kind of love the trappings of it. How do you feel now that it's over?
Totally worth reading. I had a really fun time with it. It unfortunately, or fortunately, it ends in one of those ways that's like, oh, this is such a good kind of like finality, but also nothing is final. Nothing has actually ended.
Yeah.
It lost that weight. Like, you know, a really, really good event really, really closes with gives you a crumb.
Yeah.
Of what's coming up next.
Blood Hunt.
Great.
Excellent ending.
Super closer. Yeah. And then just like a little breadcrumb of what's next. Yeah. This closes strong and then kind of undoes everything that it closed with. And it felt like a filler.
Oh man.
As opposed to a weird fun little event. Yeah. There's some genuinely creative stuff in here. They play with I mean, you're aware of Venom and Anti-Venom and
yes.
and how they function with each other.
Mm.
And then the in the last issue, which I don't mind spoiling because it was the last issue, they did this whole thing with those zombiotes.
Sure.
The infection of Carnage symbiotes. Okay. Like, it's literally like a bite. They're zombies.
Oh, okay. And so they bite you and you get a symbiote. You
become kind of like a Venom.
Gotcha.
Like, kind of like a Venom-type symbiote, but mindless.
Oh.
Living and or dead.
Yeah.
But they did this really, really great thing last issue where, because Eddie Brock Prime is the King in Black, he can speak with the whole system of symbiotes. He took the Anti-Venom symbiote from Flash and wide net killed off all of the ones that were connected via this, that really, really big, fun, crazy ideas.
Yeah.
And Al Ewing is really, really good at that. But then it got crazy and all kinds of other stuff happened. But those big, crazy ideas are really, really fun. But it all just boils down to stabby, stabby. And now this person is Carnage and that, and we don't know where this goes and that, like, it's, I don't know. It was a lackluster ending for me.
I was going to say, it doesn't sound like it wraps up very well.
It doesn't really wrap up. That's the whole thing.
Yeah, man. No thanks.
And then there's like the way that some of this dialogue is written too, like, you know, there's a big reveal. And then what they reveal is kind of like in poem. I don't know. Like, sometimes when you write dialogue that's realistic, it reads empty.
Uh-huh.
Like, you know, yes, people just talk and have sentences to each other because they're looking at each other and it's context. But when you're reading that, it just sounds like they're not finishing thoughts.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And there's a whole important exchange here about, like, I did that because it's important, but it's not why you think. And then a cryptic other line and you're like, was I supposed to understand what the hell's going on?
Right. Yeah.
It's I don't know. Like, this was, the series was, the four issues before this was stupid fun. This brought it back down to convoluted and a little edgy.
Yeah.
And I didn't care as much.
Fair enough.
There is a large, you're seeing on this page here, there is a, like, it's on the cover. There is a gold Venom.
Yeah.
That,
all new Venom.
That is actually really cool. Like, the plot mechanics that create this kind of like gold hard metal of Venom, or metal version of Venom, cool as shit. And then they don't really do anything with it.
Well, I mean, new Venom number one's coming.
It's not this.
Oh. Oh, what? Yeah.
It's not this guy.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh.
So even that tease, I don't know. We don't know what the hell's going on.
Glad you loved it.
Yeah, it's 10 out of 10. I was on the fence with this stuff. I was enjoying it because it was so weird.
Yeah.
And it got less weird and more tropey here at the end, which kind of spoiled the experience for me.
Fair enough.
Yeah, so if you're already on the boat for all things Venom, I'm sure you will love this.
Mm-hmm.
For me, who is a fair weather fan who just likes it when it's big and weird, I became disappointed when it was when it just turned into grounded comic books.
This was the Venom book's attempt to get me back on, or chance to get me back on, after Donny Cates left.
I think, well, Yeah, Donny Cates.
Kate Donny Cates. And it just, nope.
We will sample all new Venom number one. Only because they do have a chance to do something different.
Also, we're gonna read Carnage number one.
Yes.
Because I saw the preview of that and I'm like,
Yeah, maybe? which is basically how this book ends.
Okay.
It ends with that little tease. If people see the solicitations,
it's obvious.
Yeah. But yeah, it was fresh enough. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not a bad book. It just didn't sing for me. These spider books are just not singing for me right now.
What about Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles number 4? Does that sing for you?
It's a book.
Oh.
No, it sings for me. It's good.
I was going to say, this was great.
Yeah, this is a fun book. This is written by Jason Aaron with art by Chris Burnham. The fourth and final turtle-centric issue, I presume, because there's four of them.
Return to New York, part 4, Grit and a Stick.
Yeah. So in the last couple of issues, they were standalone stories. However, you started to see the threads being pulled and the brothers coming back together. The last issue ended with the other three brothers kind of, you know, crashing together, and we got to go find Donnie. Here we find out where Donnie's been, and it is wild.
So this is where we knew Donnie was, right? From the preview?
Technically, yeah.
Yeah. But we get the full story here, and it is heartbreaking, but also inspiring, because despite all the heartbreak, my man puts it together. He gets up. He's having a rough time, Donnie.
I didn't get the inspiring part. I got the heartbreak part, because he's not just broken down.
Yeah.
He's lost his faculties.
But he gets it all together enough to think things through, anticipate things, react appropriately. He's just a little bonkers. You know what I mean? Like, that's the inspiring bit, is like...
I'm not sure how they go from here.
Right.
Okay. It's not like he's broken down and weak. He has done irreparable damage to his brain by traveling to and from time so many times. Like, he is a scrambled eggs.
Yeah.
He's scrambled eggs. reflexively, he knows right and wrong and is able to kind of become capable, but I don't know where Donnie's going to be again.
There will be a comic book fix for that.
Sure.
He'll be fine.
Sure. But it's pretty wicked.
Yeah.
Yeah. The art by Chris Burnham. It's Chris Burnham, man. It's gross. It's weird. It's cross-hatchy and detailed in ways you almost don't want to be detailed, but it's okay. Of the four books so far, this is the grittiest.
Oh my god, yeah.
And
Grit and a Stick?
Grit and a Stick, that's right. I liked it a lot. I mean, I'm loving this series, but hot damn, I could totally see people reading the other three and being like, oh, this fucking relaunch is awesome, and then getting to this one and being like, what?
Yeah. Huh?
What the hell is going on? Like, like the cat meme of like,
At the beginning of this, I felt similarly, and I wondered, why didn't we just do a reboot? Why didn't we just start from scratch here? Did we need to pick up the threads from the past 150 issues? Not necessarily, but since we are doing that, I'm really curious to see where it's going. Like, I'm not off the book. I think this is a really good book.
Hell no. Actually, I think this is fresh AF. Yeah.
It's not a feel-good romp.
It's not even that. This is tonally, structurally, and aesthetically wildly different from the other three issues that were very popular. I don't know how people will respond to it.
See, I don't think it was that different from Leonardo's, where he's, you know, on the beach.
I think it's wildly different from Leonardo's, where he's on the beach, because every single of those books is the turtle is lost.
Yeah.
And they find their way through conflict. Yeah. Every single one. This one, the turtle is irreparably gone. And the way that it's presented, too, with Chris Burnham's style, it's grotesquely and irreparably, aesthetically, it is wildly different than the other three books. I personally don't have a problem with that. Mm-hmm. I love Chris Burnham's art.
Yeah.
This is a different issue.
Yeah.
And I genuinely don't know where they go next.
Yeah. Well,
I
mean, me neither.
I'm in it.
Yeah, I'm in.
But I totally can see people being very, very off about this issue.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. You don't sense that?
I could see it, yeah. Yeah. But, yeah, but it also doesn't seem that different from the rest of them to me.
Oh, I mean, yeah. On paper, sure.
Who's drawing the next... Like, this is the each issue of these four...
Derek Robertson's the fifth, and Juan Fragera? I forget that the number six is the main artist for the ongoing.
Yeah. Yeah.
But these five are different artists.
Prepare for the next issue. You thought this was ugly. Wait for the Derek Robertson issue.
Well, I mean, maybe it'll say in the back. I'm pretty sure it's Derek Robertson that does the next one. Yeah.
This whole series so far has been great, though.
Yeah, I've really been enjoying it. I am now, just like Clockwork, I am now ready for them to get into the groove of what the ordinary world is.
Yeah.
We're coming together. That's great. I understand why they didn't reboot. They've got the other Mutant Nation stuff going on.
Yeah.
I understand IDW's consternation about jettisoning 150, 200 issues worth of continuity.
Yeah.
I get it. So they rebooted one book and then shunted every other side character off into another book.
Yeah.
That's fine, I guess.
Is anyone reading Mutant Nation? Does anyone care about the side characters?
Read the first issue and just didn't care.
Same.
I mean, let's take Jenica and then just get rid of the rest.
Yeah, I like Jenica. Night Watcher, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that Night Watcher, the first issue of Night Watcher was really fun.
Yeah.
But yeah. What's next, man?
I'll tell you, it's DC All In Presents Superman number 20 by Joshua Williamson and also Dan Mora again.
Yeah.
You can't keep this guy down.
I thought the art in this book was better than in...
Who colored this? You were having trouble with the colors. Sanchez.
Tamara Bonvillain is like top tier, though.
Mm-hmm.
Alejandro Sanchez.
Yeah.
There is... The first two pages of this book is giant... recap splash pages of Doomsday's history,
mm-hmm.
and it is breathtaking.
Absolutely wonderful. It's a great double page spread. To me, the colors in this are muted compared to Bonvillain's JLU.
Yeah, in the yeah, actually, yeah. Overall, I was gonna say for that sequence, especially though, the time trapper has stopped time and they're outside of time right now, so it all is muted. But then if we go back to the actual action. It's a little huey-er, like the big boom here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's muted, but it is they do put it like a haze on it. It's a little.
This. See, you were talking about how dark the other one was. This one feels darker to me. But I mean, whatever. What'd you think of the story? I love it. Joshua Williamson has really brought me around on his Superman run. I love this book.
It's a really good book. Yeah, this is a really good issue.
I like that Lois is Superwoman. I'm curious. There's a one shot coming. You know, you and I both thought that it was because of the end of Absolute Power, where everyone's powers got flippy, dude.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently not. It's a different thing.
I'm over here comparing
colors.
Yeah, even when it's dark, it's not as dark.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. But this story is great, and also, oh my god, there's like a century moment here.
Yeah, it's really good.
Oh my god.
Yeah, this book is
grotesque.
Wonderful.
I did not expect this panel to be in a Superman comic book.
Yeah, right.
I audibly gasped. But yeah, I mean, it's Doomsday.
The house that Dan Mora built. I think I'd like him in Superman a little bit more than I like him in Justice League.
Fair enough.
Yeah, maybe. And you know what? Maybe it's not the coloring. Maybe it's just him.
Yeah.
He is better with single books, not team books, because I had that problem with Absolute Power. It's just a lot, and not moments to breathe or like one-on-one hits and action. Yeah, this is a wonderful book. I like this a lot.
Great. I like what they're doing with Doomsday. Really fun.
Yeah,
it's, you know, that's a character that felt like a one-note thing to me 30 years ago,
mm-hmm.
and we're doing something with him that I was like, oh shit, that's a great idea.
Yeah, I mean, was it always the Solomon Grundy of it all, where when he dies, he...
Well, no, I don't know if that was the intent when he killed Superman, mm-hmm. during the death of Superman,
yeah.
but when they brought him back, he had an origin story that revealed that, like, yeah, every time you kill this dude, his body adapts to not be able to die the same way twice.
Yeah, so. that's pretty cool. And I can't say I understand the cliffhanger, but that's cool. It's totally fine. I mean, I get visually what it is, but I don't, you know, those words mean nothing to me.
No, we don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know, other than that's the outfit he was in when we first met him.
Yeah, I wasn't going to say that, but yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, very cool. Love that book. Fresh AF. There's a lot of fresh AF this week. Holy
Yeah, it's a great week. And like, oof, closing it out on a fresh AF, let's talk about one absolute wonder. Oh, sorry. DC Presents All In One Absolute Wonder Woman number 2.
Kelly Thompson.
By Kelly Thompson, with art by Hayden Sherman. The anti-woke crowd are going to hate this, and I love it.
You say anti-woke crowd?
Yeah. Because they'll say this is all woke.
What's woke about it?
Okay, we're not going to have an existential conversation about like what people define as woke and not woke. No, I am serious too. They're just going to say it's woke because Steve Trevor is not the Steve Trevor they know, and they're taking away his masculinity.
Trevor. I honestly didn't know what you were talking about. To me, it just felt like
everything about this is everything about this is going to be
woke. Oh, and she dresses down the. I understand. Just, yes, I see what you mean.
Yeah.
I see what you mean.
There we go. We're in it.
I got there. No, you're right. They'll probably be mad.
Yeah, even but
like, that's Wonder Woman. She always does that shit.
Even the physicality of it, like the difference between the characters.
I love Darwin Cook is my favorite version of Wonder Woman. Yeah. Where she's like taller than even Superman.
This book is awesome. Continues to be awesome. It is a completely different. It's. You know, okay, so everything about this book is different, but it still sounds like Diana, and I fucking love that. Mm-hmm. Like, the way that she talks to her enemies, the way that she dresses down authority, even the tactician kind of aspect of her. It's as though Kelly Thompson just took the exact same character and just put them in a completely different circumstance.
Yeah.
And it feels so true.
Yeah.
Like, it's wonderful. I love this book. Mm-hmm. I love this book. And... Hayden Sherman, I think he listens to the podcast. He listens to the podcast because he took that J.H. Williams comment and he took it to heart hard. Yeah. Now, this is awesome. This is absolutely awesome. Like, there's straight up panel layouts that are W's.
So cool.
I love this book so much.
My one thing... Since we've been on the, oh dude, it's the layouts are fucking fantastic.
Yeah.
My one thing is that we're talking about color a lot in this issue, mm-hmm. and for me, this is dark and muted as hell.
Yeah, but
hell.
But it works for me because this is an aesthetic that bounces off what the pencils are doing.
Yeah.
Like, this shouldn't be bright. She comes from hell. Oh,
look at that.
Like. She comes from hell with demons and harbingers, yeah. And everything is muted and harsh. And very the mist. There is a hue of ash in the air for almost all the sequences, and it's. I mean, I think that's appropriate. Yeah. I think that's aesthetically appropriate.
It's how you would color a war book.
Absolutely. You know? Even Hayden Sherman's lines, they have like a. Gabriel Walta kind of physicality to them that it wouldn't look right in bright daylight. Yeah. It just wouldn't. But there is a moment here where I fell in love with Diana a little bit more.
Oh, Sam.
She's so good.
Nothing. Kidding. Go on.
I fell in love with the characterization. This is really, really wonderful. There's a sequence where they are finding Steve where he is.
Yeah.
And she's talking to Cersei about it, and it's just so sweet.
Yeah.
She is the embodiment of hope in a hopeless place.
Yeah.
And that's great.
What a cool, fun idea. As much as I like most of the art in this book, my only problem would be the facial, just the faces at times, the facial acting, the expressions. It just usually works, but there's a couple panels here where I'm like, that is a weird face of a character that we've seen multiple times, but just all of a sudden they have a weird face.
You're talking about Steve?
Steve, sure. Diana sometimes. Like, all of a sudden her proportions will be different facially. Like, it's a little inconsistent, but it's not enough to, like, deter me from the book.
I see what you're saying. It's usually profile. Like, when they look at each other in profile, it's a little off, but when it's all like straight on.
And then all of a sudden, like, she'll have bug eyes for a second.
Or a little bit of a rounder cheeks.
Just a little inconsistent. Otherwise, it's great.
But other than that, everything, of all the things I learned in this book, I just know that dead horses feed on magic.
Oh, he's so cute. He's so hideous, and I love him.
I love the conversation about Pegasus. It's pretty great. Yeah.
Oh, you named your Pegasus?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, this is a really good book. Yeah. Everyone should read this book.
All right, real quick. What's your favorite? What was your favorite book this week? If you're like, everyone has to read this book this week, what is it?
Oh, it's a tie between Black Canary and Wonder Woman. Okay. Absolute Wonder Woman. I think Black Canary is like a great I don't need anything else book. And yeah, it just does the character so well. But in regards to like superheroics, Absolute Wonder Woman is top tier the 2 weeks it's come out.
Period. Mine is Black Canary and it's between JLU and Superman.
I would say Superman over JLU, honestly. Personally.
Yeah.
Yeah, Superman is just kind of crushing. And I'm...
Really?
I am... Right now, I am more interested on what happens in the next issue of Superman than of JLU.
Same. Yeah. Same. But I'm on board for all of these. I don't think there was there wasn't one in this batch that I disliked.
No, the only thing that I am still on the fence about is Amazing Spider-Man.
Nice. All right.
Yeah.
This week on the show, the live stream, 8 o'clock on YouTube, we will be discussing Thanksgiving and Thanksgiving 3.
Yeah.
So join us.
It's your pre-Thanksgiving episode where we talk about, I don't know, classic Thanksgiving movies, obviously.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Murderous puppet turkeys.
I mean, they're puppets if you don't accept the realism of its own.
That's true.
The meet the art where it is. Yeah, meet the art where it is. Right. Thanks, everybody. We'll talk at you later. Have a good holiday.
Bye.
Listening to the Cult Pop Network, home to podcasts, live shows, and a whole lot of fun stuff for every flavor of fan. Follow us wherever you find your favorite podcasts, and be sure to join us live every Wednesday night at youtube.com/cultpopgo at 8 p.m. Eastern. While you're there, be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon so you'll know when we drop new Thunder Rounds and episodes of Fresh Floppies, a spoiler-free show about single-issue comics released each week. Until then, we'll talk at you later. Thank you.